All right, let's dive into a money puzzle that honestly seems to defy all common sense. We're talking about a simple action that you'd think has a simple effect, but it really, really doesn't. And I promise, once you see how all the pieces fit together, you are never going to look at your bank account the same way again. So, here it is. This is the puzzle. You go to the bank, you withdraw 100 in cash. Simple enough, right? You've got 100 more in your pocket, the bank has 100 less in its vault. It feels like a totally balanced one-for-one exchange. So how on earth can that single action cause the total amount of money in the entire economy to shrink by 400? Well, the answer is kind of hiding in plain sight, and we're going to uncover it piece by piece. You know, every good puzzle has its pieces. And to solve this one, we first need to get a handle on four key terms that define how money actually works in our world. You're going to want to pay close attention here, because pretty much everything else we talk about builds on this foundation. First up is what's called the money base, which we'll just call B. This is the real foundational, high-powered money in the whole system. It's all the physical cash floating around out there, plus the reserves that commercial banks, like your bank, hold at the central bank. You can think of it as the bedrock our entire financial system is built on. Next, we've got bank reserves, or R. Now, when you deposit money into your account, the bank can't just turn around and lend all of it out. Nope, it's legally required to hold a certain percentage of it back, in the vault, so to speak. These reserves are what ensure the bank always has enough cash on hand for when people want to make withdrawals. Then, of course, there are deposits, or D. This is probably the one you're most familiar with. It's the money that you and I put into our bank accounts. You know, that digital number you see on your banking app. It's also the giant pool of money that banks use to make loans. And finally, piece number four, cash held by the public, or C. This one's easy. It's literally the paper money and coins in your wallet, in your purse, or maybe even stuffed under your mattress. It's all the physical cash that's out there living outside of the banking system. Okay, so now let's connect a couple of those pieces. It's actually really simple. The entire money base, B, is just the sum of all the bank reserves, R, plus all the cash held by the public, C. That gives us our first key formula, B equals R plus C. Super simple, but super important. Remember that one, because we're about to use it right now. All right, now that we've got our definitions and our first formula locked in, let's tackle a little warm-up puzzle. We're going to use a hypothetical scenario to see how these pieces fit together in a nice, balanced system, you know, before we go and shake things up. So here's our starting point. Let's just say the total money base in our little economy is 800, and the public has deposited a total of 1,000 into the banks. Now, the central bank says that banks have to hold 50% of all deposits as reserves. But on top of that, our banks are a little cautious, so they hold an extra 50, just as a safety cushion. So with that in mind, what are the total bank reserves? Let's break it down. First, they have to meet that legal requirement. 50% of the 1,000 in deposits is 500. Easy. Then, they add their own extra safety cushion of 50. That brings the total reserves, our R, to a grand total of 550. And now here's a little challenge for you. We know the money base B is 800, right? And we just figured out that the bank reserves R are 550. So using that formula we just learned, can you figure out the missing piece? How much cash is actually out there in people's pockets? Let's just plug in the numbers. Our formula is B equals R plus C. So that means 800 equals 550 plus C. The answer is now just a little bit of simple subtraction away. And there it is, 250. The 550 in bank reserves plus this 250 in public cash, it all adds up perfectly to our 800 money base. The system is perfectly balanced. For now. But what happens when people's behavior changes? I mean, economies aren't static, right? A single decision, if it's made by enough people at once, can send massive ripples through the entire system. And that brings us right to the heart of our big puzzle. So let's just imagine the public gets a little nervous for some reason, and they decide to withdraw $100 from their bank accounts to hold as physical cash. Now, this is important. This isn't new money being created. It's just moving from one place, the bank reserves, to another, people's wallets. But this one simple act is the trigger for a really powerful chain reaction.
Okay, for this next part of the puzzle, we have to introduce a new rule. Let's say the central bank has set the required reserve ratio at 20%. Now, this is a much more realistic number than our last example, and it is absolutely the key to understanding the crazy, magnified effect that's about to happen.
You see, this 20% ratio is the core of a system we call fractional reserve banking.
Since banks only need to hold a fraction of deposits in reserve, it creates this incredible multiplier effect. A 20% ratio means that every single dollar in reserves can actually support $5 in deposits. This 5x multiplier, well, it's the engine of the ripple effect we're about to witness. So, remember that 100 withdrawal? It comes directly out of the bank's reserves. Now, with that 5x money multiplier in effect, what do you think happens next? Let's trace the chain reaction. And here it is. This is the core of the whole thing. The initial action was tiny. Bank reserves fall by just 100. But since every single one of those reserve dollars was supporting $5 in deposits, the whole system is now out of balance. To get back in line with that 20% rule, total deposits must shrink by 5 times that withdrawal. That's a 500 decrease. So where does that leave us? To figure out the total impact on the economy, we just need one more simple equation. The total money supply, which we'll call M, is simply all the deposits, D, plus all the cash held by the public, C. This M basically represents all the money that's readily available for spending in the economy. Okay, let's put it all together and finally solve our original puzzle. As we just saw, deposits, D, went down by a whopping 500. At the exact same time, the amount of cash held by the public, C, went up by the 100 that was withdrawn. So what's the net effect? Well, a 500 decrease and a 100 increase leaves us with a net decrease of 400 in the total money supply. And that, right there, is how it happens. So we've solved the math puzzle. Cool. But what's the bigger lesson here? Why is it so important to understand this crazy chain reaction? Well, it reveals something truly fundamental about the nature of our financial system. The crucial takeaway is this. Our system of fractional reserve banking acts like a massive amplifier. A simple personal decision, like holding a bit more physical cash, gets magnified by that money multiplier. And when lots of people make that same choice, it can cause a pretty significant contraction in the entire money supply. It just goes to show how deeply interconnected all of our financial lives really are. And this all leaves us with a final, kind of provocative thought. This entire system we've just described, it hinges on one thing, confidence. It only works because we all collectively trust that our digital deposits are just as good as physical cash. If that trust ever starts to falter, that multiplier starts working in reverse, and the system can shrink with shocking speed. It really makes you wonder, doesn't it? How much of our economy is built not on vaults full of cash, but on simple belief?